Hello everyone, welcome to the Hindu analysis for 9th March 2021. Let us begin with the first article today. Supreme Court seeks state's view on 50% cap on quota. So the Supreme Court on Monday decided that they are going to examine or they are considering re-examining a 3-decade-old judgment which fixed reservation for the marginalized and poor in government jobs and educational institutes at 50%. They are of the opinion that it is time for a relook at the 1992 judgment. What is that judgment? In 1992, a 9-judge bench of the court had drawn a Lakshman Rekha, meaning a clear-cut definitive line for reservation in jobs and educational institutions at 50% except in extraordinary circumstances. Why did this question come up? What was the need for this re-examination of the limit set by the Supreme Court? Now, if you have been following the news, you know that states of Maharashtra and Tamil Nadu have passed bills in their respective assemblies which pushed or have crossed the limit and passed laws which allow reservations over 60%. Accordingly, these two laws were challenged in the Supreme Court, showing that whatever the reservation bills that these two respective states have brought in to provide reservation to economically backward communities in their respective states have crossed the threshold of 50%, hence these laws are null and void or illegal. This was the question put forth in front of the Supreme Court, to which the Supreme Court appointed a 5-judge bench led by Justice Ashok Bhushan, particularly to hear the case of the Marathwada or Maratha Kota law. During the deliberations, the Supreme Court observed that it raised a question whether the need for this 50% quota is right for this time or not. Meaning they observed that in 1992, the cap of capping of reservation at 50% might have felt right. Does this cap of 50% justify the current times? That was the question, one of the questions that was posed during the deliberations. Now the bench decided to expand the ambit of the case by making other states a party into the case itself and has invited them to make their stand clear on the question of whether the reservation should continue at 50% cap or should it be increased or should it be removed entirely. That was the question that the Supreme Court posed to other states apart from Maharashtra and Tamil Nadu. Now, accordingly, it has framed few questions or a series of questions which included whether the 1992 verdict, where it was fixed that 50% limit for reservation, needs to be relooked by a larger bench more than the 9-judges bench. The entire idea is to take the opinion of the states also. Currently, only 2 states are involved in a legal tussle with the Supreme Court, that is, particularly in the case of reservation, that is Maharashtra and Tamil Nadu. So now they are considering to get a wider opinion from other states also, because once a judgment of this magnitude needs to be passed, they need to ensure that other states' opinions are also considered, to which they have clearly posed certain questions to other states also. One of the significant questions that the bench of judges want to answer or question is regarding the Amendment Act of 2008, that is 102nd Amendment Act of 2008. During this 102nd Amendment Act of 2018, the National Commission for Backward Classes was introduced. Now the question rose whether the NCBC interferes with the authority of state legislatures to provide benefit to social and educationally backwarded communities in their own jurisdiction. There was a question of authority over who has the authority in declaring whom as socially or economically backward communities. Now, the Constitutional Amendment Act had introduced 2 articles, namely 338B and 342A in the Constitution. Article 338B deals with NCBC, particularly the National Commission for Backward Classes. Coming to the Article 342A, it empowers the president to specify the socially and educationally backward communities in a state. Earlier, it used to be a state subject and it was up to their respective states to add or delete communities from economically or socially backwarded communities list. But with these two amendment and particularly these two articles, that namely 338B and 342A, there was a question raised whether can central government take away powers from the state government in declaring which community comes under the list or which community can be deleted from the list. As particularly in the case of 342, it empowered the president to specify the socially and educationally backward communities in a state, which was a state power earlier and still it is. And it says that it is for the parliament to include a community in the central list for socially and backward classes for grant of reservation benefits. So you have to understand that both the central government and the state government maintains a separate list for socially and economically backwarded communities. But earlier what has to happen is, when a state wants to add or delete one community from their list, they can do it themselves. But the state cannot question a center's decision to add or delete from center's list. And particularly in the case with this amendment, it gave powers to the president to add or remove without the consent of the state. There, that is where the distribution of powers or authority arose. And the court wants to dive into the issue whether Article 342A strips the state legislatures of the discretionary power to include their backward communities in the state list or not. So it again became a share of power between central and state government. Now we have to wait for two things. What the replies of other states are going to be? Will the Supreme Court constitute a 13-judge bench? Or we have to look into the fact also, Tamil Nadu has clearly asked the Supreme Court to separate the both cases. Tamil Nadu has requested the Supreme Court, stating that please don't club our case with Maharashtra Kota case, because there is a difference of sentiments, there is a difference of culture, and there is a difference of opinion. So please don't club our case with that case. And we have to wait, will other states also put forth such type of request to the Supreme Court, stating that each states have their own different opinions of perceptions of cultural identities? And we have to wait and see how this thing plays out. Coming to the next article, direct payment to farmers will worsen current crisis. So yesterday, Punjab Chief Minister Captain Harminder Singh termed the center's proposal on direct payment to farmers bypassing the commission agents as another provocation that will further aggravate the current crisis over the farm laws. So while the current engagement between farmers and government is going on, the central government decided that they are going to start paying the farmers the subsidies or the money that farmers will receive for this produce through MSP will be paid directly to their bank accounts to weed out any corruption. To which the chief minister is saying that it will further aggravate the current crisis over the farm laws. Again, the chief minister responds to a question said that Governor V.P. Singh Bandor should immediately forward the state's amendment bill again as the farm laws to the president. So the Punjab Assembly passed bills again as the farm laws, and they are currently in governor's position. So if the president refuses, it will be open door for legal course. It seems that the governor of Punjab is using his pocket veto powers by delaying his assent to the bills passed by the Punjab Assembly. Here the chief minister is asking, if he doesn't wish us, or if the president of India refuses his assent to the bills, then there is an open legal recourse for getting our objective of opposing these three farm bills done through courts. Coming back to the direct payment to the farmers, there is this perception that
a lot of money is being diverted to other sources, resources or sources other than farmers when they use commission agents. So that is why the government wanted to avoid the entire process where the government pays to the commission agents and the commission agent pays to the farmers. They want to remove the middleman, and that is why the government of India has ordered both the Haryana government and the government of Punjab to ensure that all the farmers have entered their details, bank details and other details correctly, so that they'll transfer the money to their bank accounts directly. In this accord, the Food Corporation of India, which buys the farmers' produce at MSP, has also requested the Punjab government to ensure farmers are complacent with the central government order. But it seems that there is a lot of pushback to the central government's request from the state government and from the commission agents themselves. Coming to the next article, an alarming dikkat. So recently the Haryana government passed a bill where they wanted to reserve 70% of all jobs that pay below 50,000 to local citizens or residents of the state. This is an alarming situation where states are turning more intrinsic than being outward. So, the Haryana State Employment of Local Candidates Act of 2020 seeks to ensure that 75% of all jobs with gross monthly salaries of up to 50,000 are provided to state's own resident. This is not the first time that such bills have been passed. Both the states of Andhra Pradesh has passed a similar law in 2019, and Madhya Pradesh CM has also promised to reserve at least 70% of private sector jobs to local residents. This becomes a problem when our Prime Minister is talking about unified India and states are passing bills which are contrary to that call or cry. Now, coming to the Haryana State Employment of Local Candidates Act of 2020, it imposes the responsibility on the company itself. It is up to the company to ensure that they employ 75% of the locals. So in the bill, they have given three critical action points for the businesses. One is severe monetary penalties for the perceived non-compliance, and it is up to the company to register every employee earning 50,000 on an official portal and employing 75% of the locals in such jobs. So what happens when a company has more than 25% of employees who are non-local? Should they have to fire them? That hasn't been clearly indicated here. And most of the preposterous exemption in the law is the companies must seek an exemption from the state governments if they want to employ more than 25% of non-local people into the company. And if the company doesn't find anybody qualified to meet a job in the state of Haryana, they have to either train the person or they have to wait until the person is trained to fulfill the job requirements. So these are the kind of rules and regulations in the bill that raise a lot of apprehensions about starting a business in the state of Haryana. Now, what are the problems of this bill that the Haryana government has passed? Now, it puts a lot of restrictions on the companies. It kind of brings back the age-old tradition of permitrage into the country again. Now, what are the powers that this bill talks about? Now, with this bill, it gives power to employees or inspectors to enter the premises of companies, where officials will decide if a firm can hire an outsider or should they train a local candidate instead till they become proficient enough. As it is said earlier, it is up to the company to wait till either train him directly and wait till he becomes proficient enough to fulfill the job needs and employ him, or request the government to employ an outsider who is ready to go. This will surely ensure an investor exodus from the Haryana government or Haryana state. This runs counter to, as I said earlier, Ek Bharat Shrestha Bharat or One Nation One Market slogan given by the Prime Minister. There is a lot of unemployment in
multiple states. This shows that states are turning more intrinsic because they want to ensure job they want to protect jobs for their local population. But it has a very negative side effect where it will reignite the run or need for a work visa regime in India. Meaning, if you want to work in another state, you need to get a kind of a permission certificate like a visa to work in that state, which is not good for movement of people or movement of knowledge from one place to the other place. These kind of laws will have a very negative impact on our global standing. Laws such as this that was brought in by the Haryana government do not bode well for the Indian employment name or Indian manufacturing capabilities in international standings. Already we have a very fragile name in terms of our capabilities or our employment standards or whatever you call, and these laws certainly do not help the cause of our government or our population striving to be a critical link in global supply chain. We have to wait and ensure that central government must dissuade states which are trying to bring in such laws. Yes, the idea behind this law to protect local employment is right, but forcing companies to adhere to such laws will have a negative impact than the intended one. Coming to the next article, in the pursuit of power. So China has recently conducted a conference called China's National People's Congress. In this, they have presented a 5-year plan and a vision document for 2035. The National People's Congress is a unicameral legislature, and the Chinese People Political Consultative Conference is a broad political advisor body that acts as an advisory body to the Communist Party of China or People's Communist Party of China. Now, during this conference, the Chinese government or the President, Prime Minister of China, Mr. Li, presented a document that talks about transforming China into a manufacturing superpower by 2025. During this conference, Prime Minister of China, Mr. Li, proposed 8 core areas where the government of China will concentrate to become and upgrade its capacity and become a global competitive state. Other major announcements included were expansion for the Chinese military budget, which was increased to $200 billion for the next few years, and they have also talked about China to modernize its navy, its missile arsenal and its strategic forces to challenge the US dominance in the South China Sea and the Taiwan Strait. So they are talking about an overall development of Chinese armed forces through the increased budget allocation. They have increased it by 6% and the budget allocation was $200 billion for the next few years. They have also talked about China's increasing of influence over Hong Kong. Now they are trying to strengthen their grip on Hong Kong by overhauling its election laws, which ensures or talks about only patriots running for elections. Anybody that the Chinese Communist Party deems non-patriotic or unpatriotic towards the motherland, they wouldn't be eligible to run for elections in Hong Kong. As far as the government in Hong Kong, it seems that they are pro-Chinese and they have accepted the new election law that was brought in. Similarly, Beijing or China is also pushing forward with its efforts to assimilate China's ethnic minorities such as Uyghurs, Tibetan, Mongols and others. If you are aware of what is going on with the Uyghurs, you can clearly see where they are trying to erase the entire identity and history of Uyghurs from China itself. They have arrested hundreds and thousands of Uyghurs just on the basis that they belong to a minority community. Now, China is also making moves where they want to augment its economic partnership with European Union. They have already made an agreement with European Union. Now they are looking towards Asian countries. They are in negotiations with Japan and South Korea to have a regional comprehensive economic partnership agreement with Japan and South Korea. They have an agreement with the EU, as I said, because they have a comprehensive agreement on investment with European Union. These agreements come at a time when the Biden administration is trying to muscle China into submission through economic endeavors. But Biden administration is two steps behind because China is aggressively pursuing comprehensive agreements on economic investments and economic partnerships with Asian countries and at the same time with European countries on a war footing. So this aggressive engagement for an economic agreement with various countries around the world has put India in a spot and also Washington in a spot, because Washington can no longer hold the threat of sanctions on China, because China is tactfully engaging with countries one by one, not as a group and as an individual entity. This forces countries to rethink also, because at the end of the day, any country wants an economic partnership with China due to its sheer weight or economic weight. Coming to the next article, only half of government schools, Anganwadis have tap water. So the Ministry of Jal Shakti or Jal Shakti Ministry in October 2020 launched a campaign for 100% coverage of drinking water or tap water supply in government schools and Anganwadis. It seems that they have fallen short of their goal, because information provided by the Parliamentary Standing Committee on Water Resources clearly indicated that despite an 100-day campaign to ensure tap water supply to government schools and Anganwadis, they could not ensure a 100% coverage. Now, the campaign was to provide portable piped water supply for drinking and cooking purposes and tap water for washing hands and in toilets in every schools, Anganwadi, Ashramashala or residential tribal school, and it was launched on October 2nd, Gandhi Jayanti. Now, six states, that is Andhra Pradesh, Goa, Haryana, Himachal Pradesh, Tamil Nadu, Telangana and Punjab achieved 100% coverage through the Jal Shakti Ministry's campaign. These are the only states where 100% coverage was recorded. As a result of the campaign not meeting its 100% coverage in all the states, the campaign has been extended till March 31st of 2021. And the panel also noted that children are more susceptible to waterborne diseases and are more so when there is also a need for repeated washing of hands as precautionary measure during pandemic. They are reiterating that the Jal Shakti Mission must strive to ensure that the 100% coverage of supply of tap water to government schools, Anganwadis or Ashramashalas or other tribal hostels is 100% in the next coming days, as children are moving back to or going back to the colleges and schools. Coming to the next article, will handle national security projects, ISRO. So the Indian Space Research Organization has said that it will be in charge of projects linked to national security and advanced technology. It also iterated that forthcoming missions such as Chandrayaan 2 and Gaganyaan missions and the plans to send Indian cosmonauts known as Vyomanauts into space will be solely done by ISRO, not the newly formed New Space India Limited. So the reason for ISRO issuing a clarification in this regard is because the Standing Committee on Science and Technology, which was led by Mr. Jairam Ramesh, asked whether the newly formed New Space India Limited will replace ISRO or not, to which ISRO has clearly said that bulk of commercial activities would be increasingly handled by the newly formed New Space India Limited, and projects linked to national security and advanced technology will whole and solely be handled by ISRO alone, and New Space India Limited has no say in this or no role in this whatsoever. Coming back to the New Space India Limited, the commercial arm of ISRO, recently coordinated the launch of the Amazonia satellite by Brazil on February 28. It is the first fully commercial mission from the New Space India Limited, and it also saw that 18 additional satellites were being launched in the same vehicle. The NSIL, that is the New Space India Limited, the commercial arm of ISRO, was incorporated in March of 2019, and in June 2020 its scope was enhanced, meaning new roles were allocated to the New Space India Limited. Now, the mandate of the New Space India Limited is to own satellites for Earth observations and communication applications. That is the newly formed New Space India Limited, and the first commercial endeavor that this commercial arm of ISRO took upon is the Amazonia satellite and 18 other satellites from other countries, mainly from United States. Coming to the next article, 5 themes for 75th year celebration of freedom. Mr. Prime Minister Narendra Modi was chairing a committee to discuss themes for the 75th anniversary of independent India. During this, he expressed that the entire approach to celebrations for the 75th anniversary of independence should be based on public participation and revolve around 5 themes. The National Committee, which was chaired by him for the commemorative anniversary that is going to happen next year, starts with events this month. He said that it will also showcase our achievements that we have achieved in the past 75 years, and we'll showcase them to the world. Along with our past achievements, we are also going to pass a framework resolution that would indicate our plans and our ideas and our intents for the next 25 years also. Coming to the next article, DAC to take up deals for armed drones and submarines. So yesterday, 3 armed forces or tri-services of Indian armed forces has agreed that they are going to purchase, or they have in principle agreed that they are putting up a request to purchase 30 armed drones from the United States and 6 advanced submarines under Project 75I, and they have forwarded the request to the Defense Acquisition Council that will sit in April for approval. India has been looking for purchasing armed drones from United States. Now the number has been agreed by tri-services that they are going to purchase 30 armed drones, and 10 will each service will get 10, and this has been in pipeline for a long, and it has been delayed year on year due to cost prohibitive costs and disagreements over what services needs, which service needs which type of drone, or which services require what kind of a drone capability, a surveillance capabilities. Now finally the 3 services have agreed that and they have came out with a qualitative requirements on all the processing has been completed as of yesterday. Now to a little bit of precursor, last November the Navy inducted 2 MQ-9B Sea Guardian drones, which are unarmed, from the US, which were procured for 1 year on a lease basis. There is a lot of gaps in our surveillance, both over Indian Ocean and in our border areas. To fulfill the critical gaps in surveillance and information processing, the government has been, or the armed forces have been searching for a drone that will fulfill their respective needs. So the only hurdle was US was not willing to sell us armed drones, but the US has given an in principle approval for sale of these armed drones to India a while back, and a deal was up for discussion during the 2+2 ministerial dialogue in October. As I said earlier, we discovered a critical gap in our surveillance capabilities when the standoff with China has started, where we saw the requirement for long endurance drones to maintain constant surveillance of border, and all the armored forces or each service of the armed forces felt the need for long surveillance or long reconnaissance drones, and now it seems that we are at the edge of fulfilling our surveillance needs and adding more punch to our surveillance capabilities. Coming to the next article, Afghan women leave journalism in droves. 300 women have left the industry in recent months, citing wave of targeted killings. This is a sad state of affairs in Afghanistan, where today the American government has presented a draft peace bill between Taliban and Afghanistan. They have sent the final draft of the Afghan peace accord to Taliban and Afghanistan government for consideration. During this juncture, it clearly shows that 20% of the Afghan women journalists have quit or lost their jobs in the past 6 months. It shows that whatever the Americans have fought for 2 decades in Afghanistan is sliding back, because at the end of the day, the Taliban has an upper hand in Afghanistan. The primary reason why these women are leaving their jobs, or some women are losing their jobs, is because journalists, religious scholars, activists and jets have all been victims of recent wave of political assassinations across Afghanistan, where it forced many of these individuals in their respective fields into hiding, and most of them started fleeing the country and requested asylum in countries like US and Europe. See, the killings have been always going on, but since the invasion of Afghanistan and setting up of a democratically elected government in Afghanistan, the spate of or the number of killings have sharply declined. But once America started pulling out of Afghanistan and more control was being given to Afghan security forces, the Taliban has seen a resurgence, and Taliban are again exerting their own rules and rules. But at the end of the day, it is a sad state of affairs and sad news coming out of Afghanistan. Coming to the next article, Iran slips record volume of oil into China, taps Asian clients. So when Donald Trump was in office, Mr. Donald Trump pulled out of Iran nuclear deal and reimposed sanctions on Iran. The reimposition of sanctions on Iran forced India to stop buying oil from Iran. Iran is a major supplier of oil to India. Due to the sanctions imposed by US government, that is the Donald Trump administration, India could not buy oil from Iran. In order to fulfill its needs, Iran started pumping or exporting oil into China and other Asian countries which do not fear the sanctions from United States. Accordingly, Iran moved about 17.8 million tons of crude oil into China during the past 14 months, with volumes reaching record level in January and February. Now, the new Biden administration is more engaging than previous administration, and the Biden administration is talking about rejoining the nuclear deal, that is Iran nuclear deal, and lifting of sanctions on Iran. With this, our Indian oil refineries also had started adding future imports or import requests from Iran in their future supply chain. Now we have to see whether Mr. Joe Biden will review his government's decision or the previous administration decision to impose sanctions on Iran or not. As far as the Iranian government is concerned, they have clearly indicated that they are willing to engage in talks and negotiations with the US state government, US administration, but first US has to lift the sanctions that were imposed, then only negotiations can begin between both the countries. Coming to the next article, Center likely to amend telecom license norms. So the government of India is likely to amend the telecom license norms to incorporate guidelines of National Security Directive on telecommunication sector, which will help in controlling installation of network equipment of China and other non-friendly countries. So under these provisions or under this directive, the government can declare a list of trusted sources and products for installation in the country's telecom network. The aim is to check sourcing of telecommunication technology or telecommunication products from China. Department of Telecom has already amended the licensing conditions to incorporate the guidelines of the National Security Directive. And primarily, the government is targeting the Chinese telecom manufacturer Huawei, and Huawei is in trouble with countries like European Union and US, where they are accused of IP theft and other cybersecurity and privacy laws infringement. Thank you. Have a good day.